Hallelujah. Come on and give God all of the praise. Could have been, should have been. Hallelujah. Possibly somewhere else, but because of the grace of God and the goodness of God, we are in the house of God this morning, and God is truly worthy to be praised. Amen. Just before I get in the sermon this morning, we do want to welcome all of those who are visiting with us this morning. We know that you have many choices to choose to worship, but we're so glad that you chose to physically come to 175 Second Avenue this morning, or you chose to click on that button and to watch us live on live stream. So we are grateful to God that you have chose to join us this morning. In the sanctuary this morning, we have some special guests that have joined us this morning. I think we have the Zeta Phi Beta sorority joining us this morning. Amen. Come on, ladies. Why don't y'all stand just so we can recognize you? I'm sorry? Wrong name. Oh. Y'all correct me. I'm sorry. Amen. Amen. My apologies, ladies. If I had my glasses on, I would have been able to read the Greek letters. Amen. But we're so glad to have you with us this morning, and we celebrate with you in all that you do in your organization and in the community here on Long Island. We are blessed to have you a part of our worship this morning. Amen? Amen and amen. This morning, we've had a number of sermons here lately where folk have been excited and shouted all over the place because of the nature of the sermon. And it's always good to come into church on Sunday morning and expect to shout, amen, amen, lights. Expect to have a good time. But sometimes we find ourselves in a place where we have to think about it before we start shouting, or the process has to run its course before we start shouting. But in the end, we do shout. It may be on Sunday morning, it may be Sunday afternoon, it might even be late Sunday night or Monday morning, but we will get our shout out. As we have been talking about this journey of Jesus to Jerusalem, we've talked about a number of experiences that Jesus and his disciples encountered. And I want to talk about one today, Deacon Jones, that's not a popular one. We try to gloss over it or move around it because, for the most part, we want people to shout and we want people to have a good time. We don't want to remind people of pain or suffering. But we understand that Good Friday is very much a part of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen? This morning, I want to talk about pathway of tears. Pathway of tears, or even more specifically, the place of weeping. The place of weeping. Elder Bruce, thank you for reading our scripture from the book of Hebrews that outlines for us the springboard for our sermon this morning. It says, in the days of his flesh, Jesus offered both prayers and supplication with loud crying and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his piety. Beloved, if we take in context the 66 books of the Holy Bible in which we recognize, we will find many emotions and emotional experiences of the children of Israel and the people and servants of God. We hear of shouting, we hear of clapping, we hear of the playing of the horns and the trumpets, and we genuinely tune in on these positive, jubilant expressions of human existence. But not too many times do we focus in on the weeping, the crying, or the pain, which is also accompanying these 66 books of the Holy Scriptures. It's interesting, beloved, that as we get closer and closer to Resurrection Sunday morning, during this time of Lent, we do kind of talk about, kind of think about the suffering and the pain that Jesus will experience on Good Friday. But I'm sure if I took a straw poll this morning that many of you here and those who are watching us on live stream will confess that we have had some days where tears have come down our faces. That we've had some days where we have had and we were acquainted with sorrow and pain. Many of us have experienced that human emotion of crying and even more intensely, weeping. But if you come from the generation that I come from or a generation that preceded the generation that I come from, you would have been instructed from a very young age not to cry. You would have been instructed that weeping was crying was a sign of weakness. You're not supposed or it's not good to show a form or signs of weakness. For much of my life, I grew up with this principle that was embedded and sometimes beaten into me. Even after I was beaten, I was told not to cry. Not only is crying a physical emotion of the human experience, but it is also a indwelled emotion, a passionate emotion, one of great sorrow and one of great pain. It is a release point for the great struggle that we go through as humans. If you really read the Bible, you'll understand that there was even a prophet who was nicknamed the Weeping Prophet. And he also authored a book that is titled Crying. It's called Lamentations. To lament, to cry, to mourn, to express deeply one's sorrow, one's emotions. Well, beloved, if the Bible is not silent on this issue, the Bible is open and expressing this whole idea of crying, how powerful it is to see the Son of the living God, our Savior, expressing this human emotion of weeping and crying. There's three passages of scriptures that involve and invoke this theory of crying as it relates to Jesus. You know them. Jesus weeps outside the city of Jerusalem right before he goes into it. Jesus weeps outside of the tomb of his very good friend Lazarus. John chapter 11, 32 through 37. Luke chapter 19 and verse 41. And then this scripture, Hebrews chapter 5, 7 through 10, talks about the weeping, the tears of Jesus. But even before Jesus arrives on the scene, there's a noted prophet, Isaiah. In Isaiah 53 and 5, in describing Jesus, he says, he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquity. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole. With his stripes or his bruises, we are made whole or healed. Even the prophet lets us know that the pain that Jesus would endure would be expressed in this human emotion expression called tears. It's not something that we should shun, not something that we should avoid, not something that we should try to avoid at all costs, because the reality of being human is to be able to express emotions. We don't have problems laughing, so why should we have problems crying? I've been at funeral services. I've been with grieving families where people have been told not to cry. But when we understand that crying is a form of releasing the internal feelings of our emotions, we'll understand that crying is healthy. It's healthy for us to be able to release those things that are trapped on the inside of our human existence and be able to have the expression of reality and humanity. The Hebrews writer, in talking about Jesus, pens these words. In the days when he was human, he offered both prayers and supplication with crying and tears. Let me pause here parenthetically and share with you an experience. My kids always talk about the fact that they have become accustomed to being illustrations in their father's sermons. And I remember Sam and Andrew, when they were small and things would get intense, and they would cry and they would try to force tears out of their eyes. They would squeeze their eyes and they would make the noises of crying. But because the feeling was surface and not internal, they had to force the tears. Here, Jesus was so intent in his supplication and his prayers for us. He was so deeply committed and intimately involved with the relationship in humanity that it pained him for not only what he had to go through on our behalf, but what we had to go through before he offered the sacrifice for us. Jesus, who was the Son of God, who is the Son of God, who sat at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, who was co-creators with God, has now taken on the limited cloak of flesh and became one of us. Identified with our pain and our suffering, acquainted with our grief, according to the prophet Isaiah, Jesus offered prayers unto God for himself and for the people in which he came to save. On the hill outside of the city of Jerusalem, as he saw the city, he described the impending destruction of the city. And he said that when the city would be destroyed, not two bricks from the city would be able to be brought together, even as a memorial for where the city once stood. Because of their evil deeds, because of their sins, because of their disobedience, the entire city would be destroyed. And when Jesus thought about it, he wept. He cried for the city. Outside the tomb of Lazarus, his good friend, one would even say, like a brother. He had spent intimate times in Bethany. Bethany was a place of retreat for him, where he could come and let his guard down because he felt that he was among friends and that he was safe. And he gets word that his good friend is sick, but he's in the throes of ministry and he delays his trip home for 3 days. And when he arrives, the sister of his best friend comes out to meet him and says to him, if you would have been here, Jesus, Lazarus would not have died. And Jesus' response to her was, show me where you laid him. And when Jesus finds himself outside of the tomb of Lazarus, the Bible says he weeps. Jesus expresses this intimate, internal emotion for the loss of his friend. Yes, he is the Son of God. Yes, he is pious and he is a deity, but he is wrapped in this cloak of flesh and he expresses the human emotion in this moment. So yes, crying and weeping is a part of not only our natural DNA, but it's also part of our spiritual DNA. But there is good news and words of encouragement for those of us who love God and trust God. For the word of God tells us weeping may endureth for a night, but joy comes in the morning. It does not say that we will not have weeping, but our joy is precluded by weeping. In other words, I can enjoy and appreciate the joy that comes after the intense sorrow and pain. Jesus, in the days of his flesh, experienced some of these intense times of intimate pain where he cries out to God on behalf of his people, on behalf of the world, on behalf of himself. But he does it all in obedience. In obedience to his Father. Because Jesus understands that the whole purpose for his arriving on the planet is to suffer, to bleed, and to die on a cross called Calvary. His life from Bethlehem to Calvary is about his mission and his purpose. Can you just think for a moment that woven into the thread and the fabric of who we are some days of tears, pain, and suffering? I know we don't want to acknowledge that. I know that we don't want to think about it. But if we could just for a moment think that, yes, there are these days that are incorporated in our human and our spiritual growth, but connected with those trials and tribulations is joy and growth. If I could put it in a natural analogy, everybody wants to have sunshine. Everybody wants to have those perfect temperature days. But if growth is to occur, there has to be some storms. There has to be some raindrops that will fall in our lives. So for us to be the full expression of who God is, then the full expression of God's hope for a dying world, there has to be some dark days so that we can appreciate the breaking through of the light in our lives and in humanity. If Jesus is not excluded or immune or exempt from crying and pain and suffering, then who do we think we are? That we should be exempt. And so when I look at it and I think about it, then the weeping and the pain and the tears must have purpose. See, God does not allow stuff to happen to us without a meaning or a purpose. God is trying to produce something out of our lives and in our lives by allowing us to go through some Job experiences. God is trying to produce something by allowing things to be taken away from us so that we can learn how to depend on God more. Like children, we are to be dependent on the omnipotent and omniscient of God in our lives. And no more is demonstrated than when the Son of God, the person of Jesus Christ, cries unto the Father. And what makes his tears even more prominent is because of his piety. When he begins to pray, folk pay attention. Hello, somebody. When you're standing outside of a fire and the firemen are taking pause before they rush in, you will take notice that those who have been trained to deal with heated situations are taking a moment to step back. Jesus, who was sent to deal with sin, to deal with suffering, to deal with pain, to bring about deliverance, takes a pause and endures pain and suffering himself right before his deliverance. Disciples would have him to avoid the pain and suffering of Jerusalem by saying, look, let's not go to Jerusalem now. Let's wait. Let's pause. Let's go another way. And Jesus says, no, I have need to go to Jerusalem. Can you say, I have need to weep? I have need to go through some suffering and some pain and some trial. No, we're not going to say that, Elder Bruce. Just like people who say, you know, God, I need patience. Not understanding that when you're asking for patience, you are inviting trials and tribulations. So no, we will not openly ask for trials and tribulations to come in our lives, but we understand that because they are there, they are necessary for us to be well-rounded and full-blooded children of God through our experiences. Can you imagine for a moment how powerful your testimony is after you've come through a night of pain and suffering? How powerful your testimony is when you can say, I've been there, I've done that, and got the t-shirt and the scars to prove it. And every now and then I look at the scars and I'm reminded of where God has brought me from. Jesus says, as often as you come together, do this in remembrance of me. Jesus wants us to remember his pain and his suffering. Jesus wants us to remember the times when we have to go through trials and tribulations so that it will make our victories even that much more sweeter. In his flesh, he endures suffering and the pain and the crying. And because of his obedience, I love this passage. Because of his obedience in the suffering, he gains for us salvation. Ha! See, because Jesus was obedient and didn't try to sidetrack, Deacon Billings didn't try to go around the hard moments or the suffering or the tears. Because of his obedience in it, we are able to have access to salvation. Because of the tears on the pathway, because of the physical expressions of Jesus' tears, his pain and his suffering, he endures through it so that you and I might win the victory. We can walk with our heads up high, our chest stuck out because of our connection to the overcomer, because of our connection with the resurrected one, because of our connection with the one who suffered, bled, and died for us. So, Pastor, how do I endure these moments? How do I get through the moments that, if they have not, they will come? And if they've already been there, guess what? There's some more coming around the way. Because Jesus didn't just have one moment of weeping. He had at least two that are recorded, but we don't know what was happening in all those times that he was going up into the mountains by himself to be and spend time with God. We don't know if he was weeping then as well. Just like people don't know when we go into our secret closets and we weep and cry. Parenthetically, let me say this morning, there comes a time when we have to be real with ourselves. No matter what image we want to portray to those around us, we might try to portray an image of strength and power, but on the inside, we're weak little babies hoping somebody would pick us up and hold us close. That's the reality of life, because life will throw many different darts at you. Life will present many different situations with you that will break you down and cause you to have to look to the hill from which cometh all of your help. I mean, I could pull Job, I could pull David, I could pull a number of biblical people to help you understand that in the midst of these trying situations, God proves God's presence in the midst of what you're going through. So the solution to help you get through those times that are coming, will come, or maybe you're in them right now, is to do what Jesus did. He prayed. He had supplications with loud crying and tears. Watch this. To the only one that he knew could save him. Hello, somebody. Jesus says, I'm going to look to the hill from which cometh all of my help. I'm going to look to my Father, because I know my Father is not only able, but my Father will deliver me from all of my trouble. You can sit there and say, I don't have any trouble. Yes, you do. See, because if you think you don't have trouble, then you won't call on God. If you think you have a remedy for your problem, you won't look to God for a remedy. Shirley Caesar says, while you're trying to figure it out, God has already worked it out. And if you really follow that trail, if I could really push my point, not only has God worked the plan out for your deliverance, but God knew you were going to be in the situation before you even came into existence, and he provided a way out for you. So then, Elder Bruce, I began to consciously, mentally work through this thing. That if I already know and have faith enough to know that God knows what I'm going to go through, and that God knows he's going to deliver me out of it, then yes, my tears become an expression of my intimate pain, of the physical trials that I'm going through. But at some point, my tears of pain become tears of joy. Brother Vaughn, somebody missed that one. That while I'm in it, yes, it hurts. Yes, I'm struggling with who I am. But if I look to the hill from which cometh all of my help, I begin to realize that what I'm going through, God already knows. God already knows what I'm going through. God already knows how I'm feeling and how I'm reacting. Matter of fact, he knew how I was going to react before it got here. God knew when it was down the street, turning off of Sunrise Highway, coming down my street, God knew how I was going to happen, how I was going to react before the knock came on the door, before the phone rang, before the text message came in. God knew it was coming. And because God knew it was coming, he already prepared me with some other stuff. Sister Jones' tears from yesterday are preparing me for the tears that are going to come tomorrow. I didn't understand this as I was growing up, but Big Mama used to talk about every round going higher and higher. But I looked at every round, and every round was different. But every round had some pain, some struggles, some trials. Well, how is this making me stronger and getting me closer? Well, trying of your faith brings, builds patience, patience, temperance. Yeah. So every tear, I'm getting better. And the more tears I cry, the better I'm going to get. The better I'm going to feel, because I'm releasing that anxiety, and that anxiety is being replaced with the promises of God. Because as I go through it, the longer I'm in it, the more God shows up and manifests himself. Because the more I cry, the more I'm broken down. The more I'm broken down, the more I'm depending and looking for God to lead me through it. I look to the one who is able to deliver me. So how do I handle these tearful times? How do I handle these moments of grief and pain and suffering, either through my health, through my employment, through abandonment, through breakups? I look to the one constant in my life, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, is God. Mother Reed, there's something else I see in the text, that not only does Jesus go to God, but other folk are encouraged by how Jesus handles his trial and his tribulation. Folk are looking to see how the children of God handle when it rains on the just and the unjust. Do you pop up your umbrella and begin to rain, or begin to dance and sing that popular song, singing in the rain? Or do you cry and weep and ball up into a heap because you have been overcome by the situation? Can I remind you this morning that God knows just how much you can bear? And because God knows just how much you can bear, God is not going to put more on you than you can handle. The question is, do you know you can handle it? If it comes to you, you've got to know that God knows that you can handle it. And if you're looking to him, you start out by saying, God, thank you. Thank you for bringing me to this trial. Thank you for bringing me to this tribulation. Oh, I'm in the Bible this morning, because Paul said, count it all joy when you come into diverse temptations and trials, because the trying of your faith worketh patience. But then he grabs another scripture in his Roman epistles where he says, all things. Oh, somebody gonna shout up in here this morning. All things, every tear, God is working it out for your good. Every struggle, every trial, God is working it out for your good. I'm gonna be better if I shed some tears. I'm gonna be stronger after I've shed my tears. I'm gonna be bigger after I have gone through what God has brought me to. People are seeing you. People are watching you. They want to know how you're going to handle when you get a bad report from the doctor. People want to know how you're going to handle being laid off or fired. People want to know how you're going to handle devastating situations in your life. Job's three friends showed up to be nosy, signify. They heard that he had lost everything, and they just wanted to see for themselves. And they came and they sat and they just watched him. And after watching him for a while and not hearing anything, because they were expecting him to provide some expressions of anger and frustration, they were expecting him to do like we do, complain about what he was going through. But like Jesus in the beginning, he said not a mumbling word. And as he sat in that ash heap and they watched him and he watched them, they began in the midst of the silence to provide what they thought was a reason. Isn't it funny how somebody always has an explanation for what you are going through? First of all, they don't even know what you're going through, but they have concluded why you're going through what you're going through. But when you keep reading, when you read through his dialogue and his dissertation with his friends, you will find out that he moves beyond a conversation with his friends that parenthetically can't do nothing about changing your situation. Deacon Cordigans, I find it very interesting that everybody else becomes professionals in dealing with your situation. You go and tell somebody that your roof is leaking, they start giving you roofing information. Have you ever at least even tried to nail a shingle? Wouldn't even know how to begin. Or you sick and immediately they become doctors and they want to give you medical advice. And here's the thing that just blows my mind when they come and they say, you know, when I had the same thing that you had. Well, I don't recall telling you what I have. They become professionals. But I've learned in my life, I need to go to the one who knows me because God made me. And if he made me, he knows. The Bible says we're fearfully and wonderfully made in the image and likeness of God. I'm going to go to God. And Job says, look, I'm tired of talking to y'all. Let me go to God. God, do you know Job? Yep. Know him very well. Know him intimately. Okay, God, since you know God, you know Job, and he explains who Job is. He says, well, God, do you know what's happening to Job right now? God says, yeah, I know exactly what you're going through. Somebody gonna shout right here. God knows what you're going through. And Job says, well, since you know what I'm going through, are you causing it? Or are you allowing it? If you know, you're either causing it or you are allowing it. And God says, let me ask you a couple of questions. Read the book of Job. This is where it gets really, really interesting. Let me ask you some questions. And he starts interrogating Job about the creation of the world and how things were created. And Job in that moment realizes just who he really is in the sight of God. So when we find ourselves in the midst of these trying and trials and tribulations in our lives, we realize just how small we are, but how big our God is. And even Jesus realizes that even in his person, even as the Son of God, he was small in comparison to who his Father is. So he looked to the one who was the only one that could provide saving, salvation, and deliverance in that moment. So for us, beloved, when we find ourselves in these trials and tribulations in our lives, let us take a page out of the life of Jesus and cry unto the Lord. Reach in the depths of our innermost being and look to the hill from which cometh all of our help, and not take it for granted that God is going to deliver us, but be assured that even if God doesn't deliver us, he is still God and God all by himself. That we recognize him for who he is, the omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, supreme being who is able to do anything but lie or fail. The God that we serve is able to walk with us even in the midst of our valleys of the shadows of death and grief. The God who is able to help us even when we walk with our limbs. The God who is able to breathe, help us breathe when we're losing our breath. The God who is able to supply all of our needs according to God's riches and glory. We look to him. And in looking to him, when we come out on the other side, we're able to acknowledge that our suffering and our pain had purpose. And if no other reason, we are convinced and we are confirmed that God is able. The songwriter said, if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that God could solve them. If I was never thirsty, I would not know that God could be water for me. If I was never hungry, I would not have known that God can be food and bread for me. I wish I had five witnesses in here this morning that because of what you've gone through, you have a new understanding of not only who God is, but who God is in your life. See, I can't take your testimony to help me get through. I've got to know for myself. I've got to be convinced because of what I've gone through that God is able. I can't get in on grandma's faith. I can't get in on my mama's faith. I can't get in on your faith. I've got to get in on my own faith, my own trust in God. And how can I trust him if I never had a problem? How can I trust him if I never had a pain? How can I trust him if I've never been in a point of need? How can I trust him if I've never been sick? How can I trust him if I've never been in the dark? So on this pathway to our Jerusalem, we will have some tears. We will shed some tears. We will have some moments of sorrow. We will lose loved ones. But we have to understand that earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. We've got to understand that the God that we serve is more than able. We've got to understand that we are more than conquerors. Am I talking to anybody in here that through the lives and the days that you lived on this earth, you've made it through all that you made it through? Not because you swiped a card, not because you wrote a check, not because of somebody who stepped in your life, but you made it through because of the divine presence, the active presence of God in your life. I'm going to my seat, but I just want to leave you with this. If he did it yesterday, if he did it yesterday, he's more than able to do it again. Hallelujah. If he brought you through stuff yesterday, if you should happen to endure and experience some stuff today, can you reach back? Can you check out his resume? Can you examine your own testimony where God has brought you through? And you can say, because he brought me through, he can bring me through right now. I dare you to put your hands together. I dare you to declare, thank you, God, for bringing me through. Thank you, God, for proving yourself over and over and over and over. When I think of the goodness, I said, when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done, don't look around nobody else. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, Mother Weeks, and all that he's done for me, my soul, my mind can't comprehend, but my soul, my friends don't understand, but my soul cries out, I should have failed, I should have fallen, I should have died. My soul cries out. Hallelujah. 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 I thank God. I would have you to know one more thing, and I'm going to take my seat. Salvation is a process. Okay. I was looking for a different response, so let me say it again. Salvation is a process. And the process is inclusive of some high times and some low times. Sister Bull, is a process that includes some good days and some bad days. It's a process that includes some laughter and some smiles and some tears and some pain. But because of the process, I gotta make this live for y'all. Every now and then I like to get in the kitchen, try to put something together. And one of the things that I like to do is smoke some ribs. I'm not gonna say pork or beef, because the process is the same and I don't want to offend nobody. But in my house, first thing is to cure the ribs. And Brother Vaughn. And you can't go get the ribs the same day that you're going to cook them. See, some folk just missed that one. Some of you just missed it. You got to get them a couple days in advance. And you got to prep your ribs. I ain't said nothing about seasoning. I said prep them. You got to do some stuff to them. You got to shape them up. You got to cut some stuff off. Got to trim some fat. Hello in here, somebody. You got to try to make them as uniform as you can. You get them ready. And after you get them ready, then you choose what kind of binding you want to put on. Somebody going to help me up in here. Whether you put some mustard on them or you put some olive oil, you need something on there so that the seasoning will stick to it. I said it's a process. Hello, somebody. And listen, God just doesn't throw you into stuff. He's been prepping you for what you getting. I'm going to make this thing live in here. He acquired me. And then he began to prep me by trimming some stuff off, shaping me up, and then putting some binder around me. Then he began to sprinkle. He began to sprinkle some seasoning. I'm trying to go to my seat. But some of you understand that seasoning has a twofold effect. Yeah, seasoning has a twofold effect. First of all, it adds flavor. But most seasoning have salts. And salt draws out. Come on in here, man. Salt draws some stuff out. I'm so glad that the combination of the seasoning, which adds flavor, and the salt, which draws some stuff out, God is making me better. You might not think so, but I'm sweeter today than I was yesterday, because God seasoned me, but in the process of seasoning me, he drew some stuff. Woo! And every day, I'm getting better. Watch this. I ain't even got to the heat yet. I ain't even got to the smoke yet. He just seasoned me up. And after I finish my season, I wrap them up, put them in the refrigerator. Watch this. And I let them rest. See, when you think God has left you, God is just letting you rest. Watch this. But while you're resting, Brother Vaughn, look, while you're resting, the seasoning is working, but God is getting the heat ready. Look at that. many of you got that function? I'm going to my seat, Sister Joan. How many of y'all got that function on your oven called preheat? Listen, you don't put your food in a cold oven. God Almighty, because it's part of the process. God's going to put you in, oh, when it's hot. He's going to get it ready. And while he's getting it ready, he's just letting you rest. So watch this. If you ain't going through something right now, God's just got you rested. But just know, Brother Billings, the oven is preheating. After you sit, now I like to let my ribs rest for at least 2 days. At least two. If I'm in a pinch, I'll go with 24, but I like 2 days. Because I've learned in my process that 2 days is optimal, depending on the thickness of the meat. Listen, depending on your maturity level in God, sometimes he's got to let you rest just a little longer so you can handle what's coming around. After you have properly been seasoned, you've properly spent the amount of time resting, and the oven has reached the desired cooking temperature, then I take my ribs and put them either in the oven, in the smoker, or on the grill, however you choose. But then when you put them in, you got to let them stay in. You got to let them stay. You can't go opening the door. Because when you open the door, it reduces. What'd you say, Doc? Well, see, if you are open the door, you're releasing heat, which is lowering the desired temperature. And if the temperature is going down, my friend just put it like it needed to be. If you looking, you ain't cooking. Stop looking and keep cooking. Because if you keep cooking, you will get done. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. Now, this is what, I'm done, y'all. I'm done. I'm going to leave y'all alone. This is what I like about God. God doesn't leave you in the oven too long. Because you know what happened when you're in the oven too long? You either overcook and then you burn. Now, some people like fall off the meat bone. You know, some people like that. Amen. I like if there's just a little tug to it. Just a little tug. The little tug. Because that gives some resistance. Y'all don't hear me in here. That gives me some resistance. So, listen, when the trial come, I got a little resistance. So, as Paul says, I don't get overconfident. I don't get the big head thinking that nothing can take me out of here. All I need is a little resistance to remind me that it ain't all about me, that somebody else is in control. God is handling this situation. So come on in here, somebody. God, thank you for my tears. God, thank you for my struggle. God, thank you for my trials. Thank you for every tear. Thank you for every midnight hour. Thank you for every storm that has come in my life, because you're making me better.
Hallelujah. 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 Pastor started out talking about pathway to tears, then he ended up with pathway to good ribs. Perfect analogy. If you didn't understand that message this morning, we need to get a tape and play it over again, because it should have been very, very clear. thank you, Jesus. Trust God. Trust God. Trust God. For he knows, he knows, he knows. Absolutely. There are many, many things that we don't understand, but I always say, God, you know. You know, Lord. You know, you know, you know what we're going through. You know. We just leave it in your hands. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank God for the message today in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.
The hopes on things eternal. You are whole, whole to God's unchanging hand. Come on, church. You are to
hold to his hand. God's unchanging hand.
You are the
Father, we thank you for the message this morning. We praise you, O God, that the message has gone forth and that it indicts someone in their spirit that they do not know that if they are out of balance in their life, that you could change that, allowing God to work in your life. So we thank you, Lord, for the message in the name of Jesus. At this time, we will open the doors of the church and extend an invitation to that one or two or three that do not know you, that didn't quite get the message this morning, but it's doing something in your spirit. So we invite you to say yes to the Lord, to trust God, to give it to him. Let him lead, guide, and direct your life in the name of Jesus. You can come as a candidate for baptism. You may come under Christian Experience. You may come by letter, or you may come by restoration. Just come. Just come. Say yes to the Lord. I yield, I yield, I yield to you. Take control of my life. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Yes. Eternal, eternal, eternal. Hallelujah. Is there one today? Is there one today to learn what it is and the meaning of being able to cry on the other side? No, on the side of that, that there's joy and there's growth. Is there one today that says yes to him? We do not want to assume that everyone here today is a saved Christian. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, if you're saved and you know it, say hallelujah three times. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Thank you, Jesus. At this time, we will have our altar prayer, our Minister Myers.
Let us pray. Father God, we know that we can pray without ceasing, Lord God. We can bring our knees before you, Lord God. We're asking, O God, that you would continue to cover our deacons emeritus, Lord, our deaconess. Cover our ushers, cover our trustees, cover us as preachers, cover our church, Lord God. Cover those that are in need, oh God. Cover those that are in jails, that are incarcerated, God. Cover those that are in hospitals, Lord God. Cover those that are homeless, Father, that are in need of home. Cover those that are without food, that need food, Lord God. Cover those, oh Lord God, with the presence of your Holy Spirit, those that are bereaved with your presence, Lord God. Father, we know that we can cast all of our cares upon you, for you care for us, God. We can press towards the mark of a high calling of God. Father, it's all right that we can cry. It's all right that to show emotion. Because God, you know about emotion. You understand that when you were separated from God, we understand that when you went to the cross, when you cried out to your Father, you understood what it meant to be apart from God. And that you did not want that to be anybody's plight, Lord God. You didn't want anyone to be separated from you, Lord God. You wanted people to be saved. You want people to be born again. You want people to be blessed, oh God. You want people to be healed because you're the healer. So, Lord God, we just thank you. We thank you, oh God, that you've answered prayers in our own lives, Father. You are our answered prayer, oh God. That when you died and you were buried, you rose again on our behalf. And we know that, God, you are the answer to our prayers. So we continue to thank you. We'll continue to give you glory and honor and praise. And for those prayers that we have to wait on, Lord God, we will continue to wait. We'll continue to trust you. That, God, even if you don't give it to us, you'll give us something better. We thank you. We'll give you praise and we give you glory and we give you honor, and we ask, oh God, that you will continue to bless us. We thank you for that impassionate and wonderful message from our pastor, oh God. We ask, oh God, that you would sow back to him, Lord God. You would restore unto him, renew him, oh God, for his obedience and for his pressing and for his studies. Thank you, Lord God, and we give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. For we know, as he said earlier, that weeping may endure for a night. But joy definitely does and surely will come in the morning. We give you praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
At this time, we'll have our announcements by our Minister Cornigan.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
This week, we'll have our Lenten service here at First Baptist Church. Pastor Wendy Modesta is speaking. That's this Wednesday, the 15th. And I believe it's soup and sandwiches at 7, yes. Followed by the service at 8. On the 24th, our young people will be presenting the Last Supper, and they're looking not just for you to come as a congregation or our audience, but also to be participants. I think you will enjoy it. And I know that it will encourage our young people. April 6th, we have our Maundy Thursday service. Hopefully, we will all be able to participate in that. And today at 3 o'clock, the deacon and the deaconess of First Baptist Church of Deer Park will be celebrating their anniversary.
The trustees as well.
Oh, and the trustees. So their deacons, their deaconess, and their trustees will be celebrating their anniversary at 3 o'clock today, First Baptist Church of Deer Park. Those are the announcements I have. I believe, Deacon Jones, you have an announcement.
Good morning, church. Seems like just yesterday I was standing here to remind you of the pastor's upcoming anniversary. Well, you know, time is truly filled with swift transition. For here it is again that I'm reminding you of the pastor's upcoming anniversary. He's been here 11 years. Does it seem like that? 11 years we've been blessed. And so I've come this morning to bring you, to let you know that we expect you to come and celebrate with us. For we want to celebrate this pastor for how he has been obedient to God. He's come here and he's done what God has told him to do. And it's not often that you find a church where you can hear good preaching and teaching every Sunday and sometimes during the week. And so we've been blessed. And we want to be a blessing to him. Now on April 2nd, Palm Sunday, the pastor will celebrate his anniversary. We're going to start 2 days before that, March 30th. We're going to have Pastor Adrian Reed from right up the street here in New Jerusalem. He'll be our guest preacher. And then on that Friday, we'll have Pastor Vernon Shelton. He'll come and he'll bring the message for us on that Friday. And then on Sunday, we have Pastor Ricky Harvey, who will be here for our morning service. We'll let you know about afternoon, but it's going to be an all-day affair on Sunday. There will be a meal served, but we want you to stay with us all day Sunday, April 7th. Now, we want you to be a, pardon? Second. That's what I said. I'm just checking you guys. We want you to be excited about this thing. Have you guys, there must be a lot of you that watch daytime television, right? I know it is. And I know in my house, game shows is a big thing during the day. And two of those game shows, Price is Right and Let's Make a Deal. Y'all seen that, right? Well, when Wayne Brady says, "Mary Sue, do you want to make a deal?" Or Price is Right when they say, "John Henry, come on down." Those folk jump up from their seats, and they get excited. They start screaming and yelling, and you can't calm them down. They're excited. Well, this is the way we want you to be about pastor's anniversary. We want you to be excited. When you hear it mentioned, pastor's anniversary, you should get excited. Oh, yeah. We want you out here on Thursday night. We want you out here on Friday night. And we want you here all day Sunday. All day. Tell somebody about it. Bring them with you. We want you to come with your gifts because we want to celebrate the pastor. Bring your gifts. We're not telling you don't bring none. We're telling you, bring your gifts and come help us celebrate this man that's been so committed to us, that's been such a blessing to us. Now, if he does this all year long, once, twice, three times this year, I'm sure that we could do it, you know? Come and be a blessing to the pastor. Amen? Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Well, Deacon Jones has set the stage. And that means we need to be obedient. And it's coming soon. So just put it on your calendar and make sure that time is allotted. Thank you, Jesus. Well, we certainly have truly, truly been blessed. Not many places like Deacon Jones that you can really get the true word and truly understand it. Praise our God. So we have come to almost the close of our service today, and I know that I was blessed today. How about you? One more announcement.
I'm sorry. Y'all have to excuse me. On Sunday morning, I have one thing on my mind, and that's the sermon. And I know y'all appreciate that. On Monday night, this past Monday night, the official board of First Baptist Church met. And we made a decision about our mask wearing policy. And many of you heard when you came in the church that we have made wearing the mask in worship optional. Yeah. We've made it optional. The governor a few weeks ago suspended the mandatory mask wearing policy throughout the state, but she left it open for individual businesses to determine whether or not it is mandatory or optional. And we had an intense discussion, and we have agreed that it is optional. I stand to tell you that it is your option to wear or not to wear your mask, and we will respect whatever decision you make. Yeah. That means those of us who don't want to wear our mask or don't wear a mask are not going to criticize or put those down who choose to wear them. Amen. I look at it this way. You choosing to wear your mask is protecting me. Amen. Hello, somebody. Amen. You don't feel good. You got a little tickle in your throat. Put that mask on. I'm going to do the same thing. Amen. And if I feel bad enough, I'm going to stay at home. Amen. Right. Amen, somebody. Amen. Because I love you that much. Amen. To respect you and not put you at risk. But it's important that we respect each other's decision whether to wear or not to wear. Amen? Amen. So we don't want people feeling, well, I got to wear mine because somebody going to talk about me. Well, I ain't going to wear it because somebody going to talk about it. We ain't going to talk about you. We just going to be happy to see you. Amen. Amen. Am I the only one that feel that way? I'm just glad to see you. Mask or maskless, I'm just glad to see you. Amen. So please, my brothers and sisters, pass the word that the masks are optional here at First Baptist. If things change, we will adapt to that change. But right now, as you know, we've been phasing this thing in. We stopped the signing in, and we stopped the hand sanitizer. Now we done stopped the temperature, and all the doors are open.
Amen.
Amen. So you can come in any, well, any of these two doors, but you can come in the main entrances now, and we are grateful to God that we are getting back to some semblance of normalcy, that we can praise and worship God in a healthy environment. Amen. God's blessings be upon you.
All right, let us prepare for our benediction and our offering. So we're going to have our tables. Again, we thank God for the service today, for the fellowship, for all those that have attended our service today. We invite you to come back at another time. We really enjoyed having you. As we prepare for our offering, we here at First Baptist, we hold our offering in our right hand because we want to give God what's
right
and not what's
left.
When we give God what's
right,
He truly, 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 truly blesses what is left. Thank you, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for our service today. Thank you for our pastor. Thank you for the message that has gone forth. As we prepare to receive this offering, we pray, oh God, for the giver and for those that feel they have nothing to give. And as we receive this offering, we ask your blessing upon it, that it may be multiplied for the upbuilding of this kingdom here on earth. So in the name of Jesus, we thank you, we glorify you, and we magnify your holy and righteous and precious name. May we now have our benediction. Now to him who was able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory blameless with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, for now and forever. Let the church say, amen, amen, amen. Amen. Please follow the direction of our usher as they come forth. Have a great afternoon as you prepare to leave.
Man sitting at the gate called Beautiful, and every week people would pass him by. But Peter rolled up on him and said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give unto thee. If you want to be free, just look at me now.
From nothing to something you made me. Out of the ashes you raised me. Look where I am and it's crazy.
Crazy.
Look where I am and it's crazy. I ain't depressed no more.
Ain't got a bed no more.
conquer the winter with Snowmobile. Standard on all.
I remember when he saved my life. Everything before that was just a blur. I was wild, living real foul. I just want right. I remember when he changed my name. From sick to heal, from broke to blessed. Now I can testify that I